Good morning. How are we all this morning? Oh, quiet. Gee whiz. Oh my God. The first time back in Adelaide. I was actually born across the road at the Memorial Hospital, and I'm actually, a confession to make, I am a former South Australian public servant. So I'm very pleased to be here. My father was also the first ever finance director of Medibank Private, or Medibank, back in Woden, back in the day in Canberra. And my grandfather was also the head of the Institute of Criminology, but also the head of parliamentary services at the old Parliament House, and also was chairman of the building of the new Parliament House. So I have a very big public service background. But I'm the warm-up act today, okay? So I live in America. I'm very grateful to the South Australian Public Service to have helped me with experience and lots of learning and development, but now over in the US. So I'm probably gonna have a little US-centric today. So 2 weeks ago, I was in Chicago and running exactly the same sort of program, leading with purpose and living with values. And it's summer break, which is why I'm back in Adelaide. And I was delighted over the weekend, a guy that was at the session gone down to Sabi Sands down in South Africa, and he said, yeah, I'm so inspired from doing this. And he sent me a little video. So I'm going to show you this video of how this sort of session can help. I love what I do, and pity there was no sound there. There was sound on there. Of course, the results will vary, so I'll let you know about that. So you know, back when I was, we're living really in unprecedented times, and certainly, you know, when I left the South Australian Public Service, we didn't have things like the internet and all those wonderful things now. When I was in the public service, it was a bit like this. Another little video here.
When I grow up, I want to file all day.
I want to claw my way up to middle management.
Be replaced on a whim.
I want to have a brown nose.
I want to be a yes man.
Yes woman.
Yes sir. Coming sir.
Anything for a raise sir.
When I grow up,
I want to be underappreciated.
Be paid less for doing the same job.
I want to be forced into early retirement.
So of course things have certainly changed, and in particular with the internet, and what a wonderful thing it is. And you know, I've been really lucky to work with a lot of these clients over the last few years. As you can see, half of them have a mission to kill people, so that brings a little bit of a challenge for me from time to time. But I'm going to talk to you about some of the things that I've experienced. One of the most exciting was the day I went to the Pentagon. I was invited to go to the Pentagon, and I went in there. I was waiting for my security clearance, and I was speaking to a three-star general, and while I was waiting, I said, you know, why? Why did you ask me to come in and talk to you about purpose and intrinsic motivation? He said, well, I don't know whether you read the paper, but we actually sent a nuclear missile to a commercial airport, and I think we've got a problem with motivation. I mean, this actually really did happen, so really, really intriguing. So I live in Orlando, and I live in a suburb called Celebration. That's it on the right. It's like a movie set. It was actually designed by Disney. At the end of the road is actually Disney World. Every night we have four sets of fireworks going off. It's really quite amazing. And I'm also doing a lot of work down at NASA in Cape Canaveral, which is really fascinating, which is only a 45-minute drive. So my wife and kids are sick and tired of getting in the car seeing rocket launches. And so I'm going to speak, because you guys might have heard of a guy that's doing quite a bit of stuff with space exploration, Elon Musk. So he kind of made the news over there about South Australia recently. So I'll talk to you a little bit about him as well today. So the thing that I've found, and I have to get through this quickly today, but things I've found in organizations around the world, we are very, very good at telling people what to do. We tell them what to do. We're very good at telling people how to do it, but we're not so good at telling people why. Why they do what they do. And I don't know whether any of you have heard of Simon Sinek, who set up the Golden Circle, but he talks about, you know, when people are financially invested, they want a return. But when they're emotionally invested, they want to contribute. Does that make sense? Yep. And so, you know, if you employ someone from 9 to 5 and you expect them to achieve all these outcomes, then they'll expect something in return. And what we're doing is working with lots of organizations. So it's not just about that type, what we call type X, extrinsic motivation, but how do you get people intrinsically motivated? Now, Dan Ariely also wrote a book called Predictably Irrational. And he talks about we live in two different systems. We live in a social system where we want to contribute, and we also live in a work or a financial system, which is completely different. So, for example, if I was heading back to Adelaide after this event and I had a flat tire, maybe one of you would be nice enough to come and help me change that tire. And if I gave you $1 or $2, you would find that offensive, I would imagine, true? Or if you go to your mother-in-law's for Christmas lunch and you offer to pay $200, then for most of you, they would find it offensive. My mother-in-law would probably take the $200, but you know, that's a whole other story. But whereas opposed to, you know, if we had the RAA or some mechanic, we expect to pay. Does that make sense? So we've got two worlds working at the same time. We've got a social system and we've got a financial system. Now, that leads me to three really big questions, which is the topic of today. That is, what do we stand for? Why do we do what we do? And how do you make South Australia thrive? And how do you do that from a whole of government perspective? And so that's what we're going to be looking at today. So anyone heard of a guy by the name of Dan Pink? Okay, so I've been working with him for the last 4 years. He wrote this incredible book called Drive, and that was based on a lot of research that he did on intrinsic motivation. But he talks about we have three drives. We have a biological drive, so we eat when we're hungry, we drink when we're thirsty, we reproduce. That's the biological drive. Then we also have this thing called rewards and punishment, which we call type X. Now, who likes a reward? Anyone like a reward here? Quite a lot, yeah. So we all like a reward. I used to also ask, does anyone like punishment? But I was working in Derby once, and this guy said, "Oh, the spirit of this," and he put his hand up, and that was kind of awkward. So, but if you think about punishment, you know, there's a famous story about an Israeli childcare center, and so what was happening, 6 o'clock, everyone had to come and pick up their kids, and a few people were late. So after a lot of deliberation, they decided to fine people, right? So if you're 10 minutes late, there's a ransom for your kids. What do you think happened with that? Sorry? Everyone started turning up late because they saw it as a financial transaction. So with punishment, you can either comply or defy, okay? And then the third drive we're going to talk about is intrinsic motivation, and that's really from the work of DC and Ryan. And what they looked at, they said there's three areas in intrinsic motivation. There's autonomy, competence, and relatedness, or as Dan Pink talked about, was autonomy, mastery, and purpose. And so let's have a look at autonomy, mastery, and purpose. Autonomy is that desire to be self-directed. Mastery is the wanting to be better and better at something, and purpose to contribute to something that really matters beyond ourselves. Now, when Dan did this, he looked at this and said, look, this is the surprising truth about what motivates us as individuals. But what we've done is we've discovered that this is purpose is really important for organizations to start first. So why does the organization do what it does? Then what sort of mastery do you require? And then how do you have people become more autonomous? In our organizations, what we find is we have a lot of satisfied employees. You know, we have safe work environments, we have tools and training. You know, people can get their job done effectively. There's been a lot of talk around the world about employee engagement and, you know, being part of an extraordinary team, people having autonomy, mastery, etc. But what we're really looking for is inspired employees. How do we get inspired employees? And that's from how do you get meaning from your company's purpose, and how do you get inspired from leaders? Now, I want to take you into a company called Zappos. Anyone heard of Zappos? What? Tell me about Zappos. Anyone? They're an online shoe company. Online shoe company. $2 billion a year in sales. $2 billion. They're actually owned by Amazon, but Amazon get out of their way and let them do what they like. It's like a social experiment around culture. I'm going to show you a little video and then have a look at the values that drive that organization.
It is hot. It is hot here right now. Hey, what's going on? It's Kristen Wistia. Today we're going to be hanging out with Zappos to learn about how they've built an epic company culture that is the core driver of their business and how they've built this strong culture from the ground up.
Some companies talk about work-life separation or work-life balance. And for us, our approach is really to focus on work-life integration, because at the end of the day, it's just life.
The Zappos culture is unlike anything else I've ever seen. We joke that it's happier than Disney.
It's like a family. It's like this big family, and we're happy to see each other. We come to work, we enjoy it, and we have fun here.
Company culture is our main business strategy. It's the number one priority of the company.
I think that we've always felt that competitors could copy our selection, they can copy our shipping, but one thing that could never be copied was our company culture.
From the very beginning, Fred and I interviewed every single person, but our criteria was really, would we want to go grab a drink with this person, even if we weren't in business together? And if the answer was no, then we just wouldn't hire that person.
That's kind of the idea behind the way that we hire here, is it's more important that we're getting the right people, the people that are going to fit into our culture, that are going to appreciate our culture, help grow our culture.
Performance reviews include whether you're living or inspiring the core values in others, but what we found is it's much, much easier just to spend the extra effort on the front end, and sometimes that means it'll take twice as long to fill a position, but if you get the culture right, then most of the other stuff, like delivering great customer service or building a long-term enduring brand or business, will just be a natural byproduct of that.
How are you contributing to the culture? Are you going outside your department and making friends outside of your department? These are things that you actually get scored on in order to get promoted.
When you grow like we've grown throughout the years and you have so many new employees, they're responsible for creating this culture, maintaining it, and making it better.
We're allowed to feel free to say, hey, you know, it'd be fine if we all went for a hike. Cool, plan it, do it. That's something that they really stress too, is it's all up to everyone to scale this culture and to grow with the company as the company gets bigger.
You know, Tony and these guys figured out a long time ago that you actually can get your work done, be focused, but you can also, you know, be happy and have fun while you're doing that. I don't know, we're just happy to be here because we enjoy what we do. We enjoy each other too.
Zappos has a unique culture, and what's important is not that you have a Zappos culture, but that you have a set of core values and you define what your culture is.
So as I said, this is now a $2 billion a year company, and started off as shoes and now actually almost in competition with Amazon because customers like them so much. And when they set up the company, it was very much about what are the core values. And so here's a list of their core values. Their first one is, how do you deliver wow through service? Because they had to get that first so that people would continue to buy shoes online. Okay, they also have a call center. Now, characteristics of call center, you know, scripted, high turnover, all those sorts of things. They own the world record for the longest ever call, which was 10 and a half hours. 10 and a half hours. But that delivered wow to that customer, okay? So they celebrate that. The second one, embrace and drive change. That's a core value of theirs. You know, they need to be constantly changing, and everyone needs to embrace change. Create fun and a little weirdness, so you can see that. So you can actually go there, and each department, the finance department, you know, sort of have party hats and wave and holler when you go in there, and everyone's having fun. And while it's a little bit, while it seems a little bit weird, you know, every day they're having fun and they're really contributing to something that matters and getting results. Adventurous, creative, and open-minded. Pursue growth and learning. They have a library in their organized, you know, the front of their the headquarters, and the CEO is always recommending for people to read, and they buy everyone copies of all the latest business books. So really quite interesting. Build open, honest relationships with communication. Build positive team and family spirit. Do more with less. Do any of you recognize that? So they understand that, you know, sort of in this competitive world, they have to do more with less, and they have to be really, really innovative and creative around that. Be passionate, purposeful, and determined, and be humble. Now, what's really interesting is actually when you walk into that organization and you're a staff member, on the left-hand side as you walk in, there's a tech center. So if you've got any problems with your iPad, iPhone, anything, you know, they'll fix that there and then. But on the other side, there's four people, and there's a big sign, it's called helpers, so H-E-L-P-E-R-Z. And the thing is when you go into the organization, you know, if you need to have your car serviced or a tire repaired, or you need reservations for travel or dry cleaning, anything, you just go and see those people first thing in the morning and they'll fix you up and get it organized, because they want people when they walk through the doors to do their best work. And it's really quite phenomenal to get that. And people say to the CEO, oh, you know, how much does it cost to do that? And he goes, how much does it cost if I let people into the place and they're worrying about those sorts of things? I mean, they're totally about getting the work done. And it's a really fascinating organization. For those that are interested in culture, values, purpose, zapposinsight.com. You'll get lots of information. They share that quite regularly with folks. So I was invited down to Cape Canaveral about a year ago, and working with NASA and Orbital Science Corporation, and I was asked to help them with purpose, because a lot of the NASA work is now being outsourced and corporatized. And so we spent a lot of time with them on purpose and values. And they reminded me of this. Anyone ever heard of this when President Kennedy went down to NASA once and asked this guy what he did? And he was the janitor. He said, I'm helping to put a man on the moon and return them safely. And kind of interesting. And so that's the why people do what they do. Anyway, so I have become fairly familiar with this company called Tesla, which I know is kind of interesting here in South Australia now in terms of the purpose. And in particular, I'm really interested in the rocket stuff, because I really quite enjoy those. And you know, it's Tesla, it's interesting, their purpose statement, to accelerate world transition to sustainable energy, and really looks like South Australia is leading the way in that. I mean, there's a lot of noise in the US about what South Australian government has done with that. So it'd be really interesting whether Mike Cannon Brooks from Atlassian's bet of the, what was it, $100 million if they don't get it done in 90 days? That'd be a good deal. You'd like that, wouldn't you, David? So if the 91 days would be perfect, wouldn't it? So, but also SpaceX, you know, to enable the space flight capabilities to get people to Mars. And what they're doing is, do you know, they're sending these rockets up sending these rockets up and actually returning them back to Earth now? I mean, they're phenomenal. Those rockets cost $65 million each, and they're reusing them. They're hoping to reuse them within a week. And so I've got a little video clip of something that they've been doing. When you look at this video, when you see it at the end, first of all, the folks that are doing this look about 20 years old, doing just extraordinary stuff. But when was the last time people in your organization reacted like this at the end?
VC, start to launch auto sequence.
In order.
Prop, confirm you're ready for engine chill in 30 seconds.
Prop is ready for engine chill.
The spacecraft are on internal power.
Stage 1 locks, stage 1 fuel, stage 2 fill rates all nominal.
All stations verify, ready for launch, all stations acknowledge. FTS.
FTS go.
Prop.
Prop go.
AVI.
AVI's go.
GNC.
GNC go.
OSM.
OSM go.
Recovery.
Landings go.
LCLD, go for launch.
T-minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We have liftoff for the Falcon 9.
Stage ignition.
Stage one is at its foot. Stage one boost ramp is starting.
So this is the kind of stuff that Elon Musk is doing over in Orlando, and I'm really excited to see what he's going to do over here in South Australia over the next few months. And I'm just going to wrap up right now, and after George speaks in the break this morning, I'll talk to you more about some of the things that are happening in terms of the public sector in the USA. But what's really interesting, you see the enthusiasm from the people at Zappos and also there at SpaceX. But the research will tell us that 58% of people in the US would actually take a pay reduction to work in an organization with a meaningful purpose. I think that's really, really significant. Only 24% of US workers actually think their work is meaningful, and a further 17% aren't sure. And it's incumbent to all of us as leaders and leaders in the South Australian public sector to make sure that we provide meaning for everyone in the public sector, and to understand why we do what we do in each of our departments to make South Australia thrive, and to ensure that we have the right values to inspire people to do their best work. Now, what I'd like to do is hand over to George Savvides now to talk about the Medibank story and to provide you with some more context. So would you please join me in welcoming George to the stage?